Very good afternoon to every one of you here. I think it's the time for siesta for many of you. After a heavy lunch, probably you feel you are strongly inclined to take a nap or a siesta. Siesta is the favorite word of R.K. Narayan. Almost in every fiction work of R.K. Narayan, you come across the word siesta. So, every writer has got favorite words, their own favorite words. And so R.K. Narayan does in the same way. August dignitary on the stage, my co-presenter. And August dignitary is present in front of me. Scholars in English literature. My beloved guru, Dr. S. Subbaiya, who directed me to give me a seminar here. Dr. A. Kalaidasan, who is not here, whom I remember all the time for what I am, for molding me into a scholar. My very good afternoon to every one of you. And I have been assigned the topic, Problems Confronted by a Translator in Practical Translation. When my guru asked me to do this kind of, give a speech on this practical problems confronted by a translation, I was just strongly reminded of the preface I wrote for my friend who translated Bharatidasan's Adanin Sirikul. My friend who is a teacher in a convent school, he translated the work of Bharatidasan's Adanin Sirikul, The Laughter of Beauty, whatever it is, he translated. He gave the work to me and he asked me to present a foreword or a preface for his work. My very first sentence for the preface was like this: translation is always an imperfect exercise. It is always an imperfect job. You can never go to the soul of the original author, actually, as you say, the source language. You never know the soul of William Shakespeare. You never know the soul of William Wordsworth. In what spirit he delivered his work of art, we do not know. Yet, we just go to the level best, to introspect, to go dwell, or we dwell deep into the original author's original work, and we try to extract what we can from this one. And against this backdrop, that translation is an imperfect exercise. For instance, my friend, I think Professor Arasu once assigned me, Thidum Nandrum Piranda Vara. How will you translate into Tamil? It is into English. Thidum Nandrum Piranda Vara. My friend Dr. Arasu translated it, good and bad none doth bring. Good and bad none doth. He translated into this way. So, again, translation is an imperfect exercise. But remember, what is important for a translator is a good stock of vocabulary. So he should be enriched with a good vocabulary to be a practical translator and retain and capture the original essence of the original work of art, and that's very important. And against this backdrop, again I would like to highlight the work I have done. For instance, I was translating a very famous work, as you know, the first poetry work written in English literature, Geoffrey Chaucer's Canterbury Tales. It's a very gigantic work, a work written in the 14th century. 6 centuries ago the work was written, and 6 centuries later the work remains fresh. With its kavita, with the criticism of the temporal authorities, or the ecclesiastical authorities, Geoffrey Chaucer's book is a complete document. It's a poetical document, no doubt about that. And when I was attempting to translate poetry of Geoffrey Chaucer, I was attempting only the prologue part. I attempted the prologue part, I translated it. What I felt was, there was a depth of some words that could explain the real spirit of Chaucer's poetry. So I wanted more, a stock of good vocabulary, for which I just read the entire Bible first. The entire Bible translation in Tamil I went through, and I learned the vocabulary stock from the Bible, and then I just proceeded to translate Geoffrey Chaucer, because I have to read Geoffrey Chaucer only against the backdrop of the culture of England. First I have to go to the very culture of England, the language they speak, the religion they practice, the food they eat, the practices they have, the customs and oaths they follow, and when I come to acquaint myself with against all these things, then only I can be a successful translator. So against this, all these things, I acquainted myself with vocabulary, good vocabulary of words, and I translated, and I made a feeble attempt in which I have translated this Prologue to Canterbury Tales by Geoffrey Chaucer, and of course one more tale, Nun's Priest Tale by Geoffrey Chaucer. This was my attempt. And then when I went through some other works which could be transferable, because there are some certain works that are very entirely difficult to translate. So some works are transferable and translatable. And again, when I was translating metaphysical poets, I was translating John Donne's poetry. You are familiar with the valediction forbidden mode, where John Donne proposes that compass imagery, very familiar, very popular thing about the separation of the lovers. And John Donne is separated from his lady love. And he says, like the other leg of the compass, and you imagine the compass imagery in John Donne, other leg of the compass that goes around the main, the center. I am separated from you, it is not a separation, and it goes direct and it comes home. That is what you read in John Donne's Valediction Forbidden Morning. When I was translating this, இரு கவராச முனைகள் தெரியாது இருத்தல் போலே, this was my translation. கவராசம் was the word I used. Our students are very familiar with the word compass. Everyone uses the word. A child of grade 2 will use the word compass. But I was particular about using the word kavarasam, because I wanted to use a word which is archaic also, old, and it was used by the students of the past era. Several decades ago, our students were using the word kavarasam. That is the right word for compass in Tamil. So to this extent, we have to be specific in translation. So again, when I was translating the poetry of Shelley, Ode to the West Wind, very familiar poem. Everyone knows about the effect of the poem, the romantic poem, Ode to the West Wind by Shelley. And when I was translating the concluding lines, I was too emotional while translating. So when Shelley translates the concluding, when Shelley writes the concluding lines, he pours out all his emotion. It is the very life that of Shelley. It is the hallmark of romantic poetry when he says, lift me like a wave, a leaf, a cloud, I fall upon the thorns of life, I bleed. And that is the emotion and the energy Shelley pours into Ode to the West Wind. And when I was translating this, I translated, Ennai alayana ilayana megamana ennai mel eluppuvai mulgalin mel naan velundu kidakkiren ayyoho koozhi vadikkiren. This was my translation. I there is no word ayyoho in the original text. You don't have the word ayyoho, but Shelley uses the plosive sound, I fall upon the thorns of life, I bleed. When Shelley uses the word bleed, it is Shelley shedding blood on the thorns. I fall upon the thorns of life. My translation runs like this. Alayana, ilayana, megamana, ennai mel eluppuvai. I fall upon the thorns of, lift me like a wave, a leaf, a cloud. I fall upon the thorns of life, I bleed. This was my translation. Again, I have one more experience, because this is an emotional experience. When I just to translate this romantic poetry, I have to be a romantic. Once T.S. Eliot said, the growth of an artist is complete subjective experience. The growth of an artist is killing myself. And romantic poetry is felt. And romantic poets were shedding tears. All of them had love failures. So necessarily there is no happy poetry in romantic poetry. It is all sad poetry. It is shedding tears. And again, you come to Emily Dickinson. There is a famous poem, I heard a flight buzz when I died. That's a famous poem. Dear Pansh. I heard a flight buzz when I died. Now I translated in this way. நான் மரித்த போது ஒரு பூச்சியின் சப்தம் கேட்டேன். And why I use the word maritha bodhu? Because maritha bodhu namm yaarume solradhilla. Ippa eppa you just take the case of anyone, ippa irunga enna solra irandu ponaar iyarkai eludinaar appadi than solranga. But when I translated, I intentionally used the word, naan maritha bodhu oru poochiyin sabdathai kettaen.